Well, I can safely tell you what I wasn't doing last Monday night. It's the same thing apparently a lot of you also weren't doing, and that's watching Monday Night Raw. The rating for last week's show, a 2.3. 2.3. What a joke and a half. What an embarrassment. It's like 1997, the bad part of 1997, all over again. I don't think this is surprising. I think a lot of people with brain matter inside of their noggins could have seen this coming. I know I most certainly could have. When I sit there and I see that 2.3 rating, to me, these are the WWE's chickens coming home to roost. They are reaping what they sowed. They deserve every fucking bit of this that they get and will continue to get. And if you think this is the absolute bottom, you're freaking kidding yourself. I mean, you really, truly are. And what I'm worried about is what this means. Not so much for the here and now, because the here and now is the here and now, and there's enough of an infrastructure of the WWE put in place to protect themselves against a time like this, at least for the moment. So I'm not as concerned about the present. What I'm worried about, and what you should be worried about, is the WWE's future, and in particular, the long-term future. And not so much just from a standpoint of worrying about whether the company will be around 5 or 10 years from now. That might be an overreaction. That might be going too far. But severe, significant concerns about what this company is going to look like down the road, I think those are very legitimate questions to have. And here's why. I mean, let's start off with the ratings. You know, there was a point in time during the Monday Night Wars when the WWF was splitting an audience with Monday Nitro every week, where between the two shows, they're doing 10, 11, 12 million viewers, to the point where they were doing so good that it negatively impacted other Monday night shows, most notably Monday Night Football, to the point where Monday Night Football's ratings sagged so much that they made some significantly ridiculous, dumb decisions over a period of time that I like to refer to the let's never talk about them again Monday Night Football years. To the point where a few short years ago, we were worried and talking about the company doing a 3-2, 3-3, 3-1, then it becomes a 3-0, then it becomes a 2-9, then it becomes a 2-8, and then it's always the excuse of, well, it's during the football season, so the ratings are going to sag, which is horseshit, which is just making excuses. That is in no way a justification for your ratings sagging. That is inexcusable, and that is unacceptable. But now we've reached the point where it's 2.3. What's your excuse now? If over the past 4 or 5 years we've gone from them still doing a 3-2-3-3 every Monday night to doing a 2-3 on Monday nights, imagine the 1.3 that's going to come 5 years from now if shit doesn't change. I mean, think about that. And if you think that's not legitimate, did you ever think Raw was going to get to the point where it's consistently drawing in the twos with an extra hour to draw off of on top of that? You know, this is happening for so many different reasons. One of them, of course, being the fact that the WWE storytelling is atrocious and basically non-existent. They couldn't book a good feud to save their fucking life. Horribly stupid finishes to matches. Events that have no consequence, meaning, or significance. No reason to get invested in them. So why should people get invested in them? Why should they invest in them? So what happens? The WWE goes back to the same old tired patterns. Instead of trying to build up new stars and breathe some fresh life into their product, they go back to the tried but true hands. They'll go to the part-timers, they'll focus more on the guys that they've focused on for so many years already, who, mind you, haven't exactly done a whole lot to help get you out of the situation that you're in. When you look at the part-timers now that they still go back to, they throw out a Sting. They throw out an Undertaker. They throw out a Brock Lesnar. They'll be bringing back a Rock soon. You know, at some point in time, they'll be bringing Triple H back in an in-ring capacity. Here and there, they go back to the well with guys like Chris Jericho. All right. That shit's already starting to get old now. Imagine 5 years from now. Just think about this. When these guys are 5 years older. When Sting's in his early 60s. So, he's not going to be a factor anymore. You know, Taker's going to be in his mid-50s. I most certainly don't expect him to still be wrestling then. The Rock's going to be in his late 40s. He's probably not going to want to wrestle anymore. Triple H already doesn't seem to really want to wrestle, and he's in his mid-40s. Imagine what it's going to be like when he's in his late 40s or even later on in his early 50s. Jericho only wants to come back here and there and primarily only wants to work house shows. 5 years from now, he'll probably be totally done with it, a couple years removed. So you're not going to have those part-timers to go back to. What part-timers are you going to have at that point in time? What, guys like Kane and Big Show? Again, these are guys that you've overused for far too long in far too many ridiculous ways. And even if they were still around in any capacity 5 years from now, you're talking about an early 50s Kane and a late 50s Big Show. And how ridiculous is it that two of the most prominently featured people on your television today are people that have been prominently featured on your television for over a decade and a half now in Kane and the Big Show? And not just featured here and there, consistently featured week in and week out. Kane and Big Show! You're most certainly not going to get any pop from using them as part-timers down the road, because you're not even getting a damn pop from using them now. But then look at the other guys. You look at guys like John Cena and Randy Orton, to a lesser degree, Sheamus. You know, no matter how much they try with Sheamus, even though they do a poor job with it because everything they touch basically sucks now, you know, he's not a star. He should be, but he's not. And part of the reason is because he's born as fucking piss. Excuse me, sometimes piss can be entertaining. Sheamus is not. It hasn't been for a long period of time. Sorry, gold standard, up yours. Imagine 5 years from now when he's pushing 40 and he's still not fucking over as a top guy. What are you going to do with him then? And you look at Orton. You've already removed him to semi-part-time status. All those years of pounding him down our throats. All those years of investing so many resources into him and so much effort and energy into him. And you've never gotten anywhere close to a full legitimate return on that investment. And you're most certainly not going to start now. And while at least Orton is willing to put some people over, at the end of the day, you've basically turned Randy Orton into a mid-30s glorified jobber. What the fuck is he going to be when he's pushing 40? And then we get to the freaking Cena monster himself. You know damn good and well that you're never going to get nearly the return on the investment you've made into propping up Cena as your corporate tool after all these freaking years. And think about it. He'll be in his 40s by that point in time. Who's to say he's not going to want to go off to do Hollywood or want to sit there and do whatever the fuck him and Nikki Bella do? Who the fuck knows and who the fuck cares? Well, frankly, we should care because you've invested so much into this basket for so damn long. And eventually those eggs are all going to shatter. And then you're going to get shell in your yolks. And then you're going to wonder what the fuck to do next. I mean, seriously, Christ almighty. You're never going to get anywhere close to a full return on everything you've put into Cena. Because 5 years from now, if he is still around in some type of full capacity, it's still going to fucking be about him. 15 years after the nightmare started, it will still be going on stronger than ever. 36-time world champion! Oh my god, he's the greatest thing ever! You can't turn to him as a fucking part-timer. It was 5 years ago, he'll probably still be the full-timer. And if you turn to Orton and Sheamus as part-timers, nobody's going to give a fuck. Because they never reached megastar status. At least guys like Taker and Sting and The Rock and, yeah, to a lesser degree, Lesnar, but yes, a Triple H as well. And to a lesser degree, Jericho. They all reached some level to varying degrees of superstar status during their peak of their powers. Something Cena, sorry, has never fucking done. Something Orton, sorry, has never fucking done. Something Sheamus most certainly has never fucking done. You can't go down this part-time path forever because A, the part-timers that you have aren't going to be able to do it much longer, and B, you won't have any future part-timers to fucking turn to. Which, of course, all the while means what's for that next generation. The guys in their mid and late 20s that you should be building your company around. The guys that you should be making into huge stars. Ah, you're wasting your time. You're just waiting until whatever the fuck. You know, you've put Rollins in this horrible title reign. You're spinning your wheels with Ambrose. You're spinning your wheels with Reigns. You're spinning your wheels with Wyatt. And frankly, 5 years from now, maybe one of these guys you'll actually get on the good foot and do the bad thing with and do some good business with. But one, if not two of them, will probably be out of the fucking company at that point in time because either A, they'll have other options, or B, they just don't want to fucking be in this cesspool of suck anymore. It goes for anybody else in that age group as well. Cody Rhodes, Big E. All this company is going to do is continue to hold them down. All this company is going to do is continue to waste fucking time like they've already done for the past couple of years and will continue to do so going forward. So not only will you not have the part-timers to draw off of, you also won't have that next roster of legitimately established main top guys that you could depend upon, that you can rely upon. Fortunate for, at least when you had Cena, Batista, Edge, and Orton, you had four guys that you could count on to give you a certain amount. 5 years from now, you ain't going to have one of them. Not a one. Well, except John Cena, because this company won't ever fucking quit him. We can't quit you! Flat tops and jorts, FTW! Now, you think about it, too, with the WWE Network. This thing's been around almost 2 years now. And the company's got access to it all over the world. And they're supposed to have this huge, allegedly massive international audience that they always cook the numbers on when they talk about their social media followers and the number of people that have some type of vested interest in WWE. Yet when you look at their subscriber numbers, that tells you an entirely different story. You know, it's one thing when you're getting it off the ground level that, you know, the audience takes time to build up. I understand that. And I take that it takes a while to build that up. But, you know, we're almost 2 years in now. And you can't exactly call the network a raging success. And this was supposed to be a big part of the company's future. And I don't really see how, with your domestic television audience dropping, meaning your international television audience can't exactly be booming, that your subscriber numbers are going to all that much pick up over the next few years. To the point where you're still trying to defend the numbers in 2020 that you were drawing in 2015 because they're going to be the same fucking numbers. And you look at Vince McMahon, for example. You know, in 5 years from now, I don't think anybody reasonably anticipates that he's going to be gone from the company. He'll still be running the show. And I think back to when they talk about that meeting, I think it was Foley was talking about, and others have talked about it too, back in, I think it was 97 in Kansas City, I believe it was. And Vince goes to the talent, tells him that he doesn't know what today's pop culture is. And he's out of touch. And that was 52-year-old Vince McMahon. Now he's 70. You've seen how out of touch Vince has become in recent years. And how out of touch in particular he is now. Imagine how much worse it's going to be 5 years from now with a 75-year-old angry grandpa Vince running the fucking show. It's like angry John McCain is run amok without any of the redeeming qualities of Senator John McCain. This is the guy that has micromanaged this company to a point that it's created the situation that they find themselves in now, so the only way he's going to fix it is by doing the thing that has put them in the spot that they're in by micromanaging it even fucking more. Can you imagine how much better, how much worse it's going to be 5 years from now when he's in his mid-fucking 70s? And then he's thinking about at the end of his days and his legacy, oh my fucking Christ almighty. And then you look at the succession plan. Oh, succession. Oh, that's a strong word. Because that carries the word success in it. And that would imply that Triple H and Stephanie running the show is going to be a whole lot better or a much bigger success than Vince running it now. And if you think that's the case, knock knock, who's there? Reality, wake the fuck up! Because all we want to blame Vince for everything. And at the end of the day, he's created an environment, understandably so, because he's the HNIC of all that we see when it comes to WWE, as I've said for years now. And that's true. So the buck stops there. So ultimately, he is the guy. Everything runs through him. Everything funnels through him. But things would be better if people around him were better and people around him brought him better things. Because if everybody brought him something good and he had to go with something, he's ultimately going to choose something good. If everybody brings up a bunch of bullshit, then he's still going to go with the bullshit and then he's going to put his bullshit spin on it and make it even more bullshit. Think about this. So many of you like to talk about the WWE's writing staff. Some of you even still refer to them as a creative team. Although creative is anything but a very strong word when alluding to that group. Those poor people. You imagine the miserable fucking lives they lead. Who's the one that carried through on this philosophy of bringing in script writers from Hollywood and soap opera writers and comedians and everything other than wrestling people to book wrestling and write wrestling and sports entertainment programming? It was fucking Stephanie McMahon with Vince's blessing. Stephanie did it. You magically think now that Vince being out of the fucking way, it would be better under Stephanie? Bitch, please! Aptitude for writing, in particular wrestling or sports entertainment, television, is not something that you could get surgically enhanced. You just can't go visit the plastic surgeon and sit there and say, give me sports entertainment knowledge on my cranium like it's a nose job and your life depended on it. These things don't grow like boobies out of silicone. If you think it's going to be better under her, you're fucking crazy, and Triple H as well. You really think it's going to be that much better under Triple H? Look, a lot of you will point to NXT, and I granted, I give you. I like how NXT makes a big show feel like a big show, but this is still a minor league operation with a larger production budget. Let's not get too carried away. From a week in, week out standpoint, the show is largely shit. And it's largely a reflection of the same shit we see on Raw every fucking week. It really, truly is. Instead of having 3 hours of television where they can barely carry two stories, we get Triple H's version, Hunter's version, Paul's version, whatever the fuck you want to call it. One of the three books of God, Christ Almighty. You get 1 hour where they can barely carry one fucking story and develop one fucking character. So you think that him doing NXT that a lot of you jerk off to, because frankly you can't jerk off to WWE anymore other than the Spots Fest and the freaking matches on the fucking special event pay-per-views. You think that him running it is going to be so much better? A guy who seems to be just as racist as Vince, who has significant ego problems, and is just as quick to bury anybody as Vince ever fucking has been. Well, excuse the fuck out of me if I ain't fucking buying that this guy's going to be any better than Vince. Vince has got all this baggage and all these bad things, but he's also accomplished a lot of shit running that show that Triple H can only fucking hope and dream of doing someday. As bad as Vince is, I'll take Vince over Stephanie and Triple H. You best damn fucking believe that. And what's the scariest thing of all, though, is when you look at the professional wrestling and sports entertainment landscape and the future of that. You look at the fact that WWE and Vince McMahon in particular have always been at their best when others have been at their best. More importantly, when others had ideas that Vince McMahon and the WWF/E could take off, rip off, and remake and make their own and make them better. Hulkamania was a Vern Gagne concept that Vince took national and then international. He was smart enough to do it. Vern was not. Vince McMahon took Starrcade, Dusty's idea, and made it WrestleMania, put his own spin on it, and made it bigger and better than Starrcade. Vince McMahon took what ECW was doing, and then after that, what WCW started to do, in part as a reaction to ECW and starting to rip off ECW, which they did, and made the Attitude Era out of it. And that was the nexus for the turning point of the Monday Night Wars and all this other shit. When the Vince McMahon-led WWE has been at their best, it's when other people have been there for him to steal talent from, rip off ideas and concepts from, take, make his own, and make better. He doesn't have any of that. Who's he going to fucking steal from now? TNA? ROH? Yeah, there's a period of time where he stole talent. I guess you'd say steal talent from ROH. He signed them away. He's not exactly going to steal their storylines, their concepts, their ideas. And God knows when they freaking do see the Summer of Punk of 2011, we see how poorly that fucking turned out. I mean, he can't even fucking steal ideas anymore and make them good. Oh my God. And there aren't a whole lot of ideas and concepts and people for him to steal anymore that's worth it. Imagine how much worse it's going to be 5 years from now. TNA is probably going to stubbornly be clinging on, you know, because that's what they've done, frankly, for the past 13 years. So at this point in time, I'm not going to fucking bet against them. ROH is probably going to be doing the same lame shit that they continue to do and they have largely done throughout their 13 years of existence. You know, the rest of the business is going to be what the rest of the business is. And Vince McMahon's WWE's business is even going to be worse than you only fucking imagine. Holy Christ. And even more frightening is the thought of what that's going to mean for the future talent in the business. You know, the people that grew up in the 60s and 70s became the stars of the 80s. The people that grew up in the 70s and 80s in part became the stars of the 90s and the 2000s. The people that grew up in the 90s, they became the, I guess you call them, stars of the here and now, and not exactly major stars at that. Imagine people that have grown up watching this shit over the past 5-10 years, that 5-10 years from now, they start breaking into the business. They frankly have legitimately never seen a really good period of WWE. They've never experienced it live. They've never seen it. They're going to think storylines like the Nexus were really good, they're going to think that the Summer of Punk was awesome. They're going to think this, and they're going to think that, and they're going to be so spun up because they were raised on a generation of WWE propaganda. No matter how much the internet tries to spin them away from this bullshit, it's not going to help. And you've seen the change in the business in terms of the type of people that get into the business and the type of people that stay in the business. That's not a good change. We're not bringing in a bunch of actors and football players and bodybuilders and all different types of people. We're bringing in guys that look like fucking me. Like, legitimately. And aren't even in as good of shape as me, as sad as that is. And these are the guys that we're pushing to the moon! Guys that the next time they hit the gym will be the first time they fucking hit the gym. The guys the next time they do cardio is going to be the first time they do freaking cardio. The next time they cut a good promo is going to be the first time in their ever loving fucking life that they cut a good goddamn promo. That's the future of the business. You think it's bad now, just wait. It's going to get worse. It's going to get a whole lot worse, I assure you. If you think it's bad for WWE now, I got news for you. You ain't seen nothing yet. And if you aren't scared of what the future holds, you should be. You should be worried. You should be terrified at the thought of the possibilities of what's yet to come. Because I know I am.